biotechnology, and she's currently pursuing her M.Tech from IIT Hyderabad. She also went to Portugal for the semester exchange program in 2019. That is in her sixth semester, and that's it, I guess. Anita, you can take over. Also, if you have any questions, you're free to put it in the chat box, or we'll also have in Q&A session at the end, so you can ask that directly. Anandita, you can take over.
Yeah. Hello, everyone. Am I audible, right?
Yeah, you're visible.
Yeah, okay. So, hello, everyone. I guess all of you are safe and sound. Okay. So, thank you, Brishti, for introducing. And right now, like today, I saw your like perfect queries and all. So, specifically, I'll be first talking about like I'll be giving in general a view about the SEM exchange, and then I will try to answer your queries. And if still like some of your questions are left out, it is not like answered. If you think so, then you can ask. Feel free to ask. And also in between, if I'm like not audible or you are having any problem in following me, you're not able to follow, then please feel free to stop me. Okay. Okay. So I'll directly jump to start the presentation. Wait, let me start presenting. Okay, the slides are visible, is it? No?
Yeah, it's visible.
It's visible, okay? Yeah. So, in general, first, like the main question what I saw you people had is what is the difference between a semester exchange and a research intern? Okay. So, first of all, let me tell you the main difference between semester exchange and research intern is that in research intern, you specifically go to work under a project. Okay, you go to a lab or to any university, wherever you are going, you are getting selected and you are going to work under a project. But in semester exchange, the scenario is totally different because you will be a student of that university where you are going. So, like you will be the student of that university for that semester, and so you will be studying in their classes, you will be writing the exams, you will be having the exams and everything in that university. So you can say like I'll be the student of this university for this semester. It's kind of that kind of a scenario, and that's why like there are differences in application process and the SOPs and cover letters and everything, and also eligibilities. Because the two things, research intern and semester exchange, both are different. So in semester exchange, the first and foremost thing is that you should confirm like what IJ is still working. The MOU should tell you if you are like you can proceed with the application or not, which is not the case for research intern. Okay. And for research intern, like you can apply yourself. That's the main difference, I would say. And also like the stay period, it's longer for semester exchange because you'll be staying for at least 4 to 6 months, depending on the semester tenure in that university where you are going. It's mostly 4 to 6 months only. And also, this is specifically for second years and third years. Some exchange programs like Erasmus Mundus, they also allow you to go for a whole year. So you will be going for 2 semesters. That also happens. It depends on the program you're applying. Okay. So yeah, that's the main difference between research intern, semester exchange and research intern. Now going for the application process, if I go into three steps, like before the acceptance, like while you are applying, second, after you are getting accepted, and third, after you come back to your home institute. Okay, so there are basically, like, you can say home institute is the institute you are currently studying, that's NIT Warangal, and the university you will be going is host institute. So these are the particular terms which are generally used. So yeah, before acceptance, like while applying, the main three things focused on should be your application, okay? Your SOP, how the SOP should vary. First of all, let me tell you, CGPA, many of you had this doubt that is CGPA the criteria? Of course, CGPA is a criteria. It's one of those criteria, but you can't say that it's the sole criteria, you know? Because generally what happens actually, most of the semester exchange, they will not have any interviews. Like, you know, for MITAX and all, generally after the application process, there's a second step. If you are, if you cross the application process, if you are selected after that, then they'll take an interview of you. But for semester exchange, it doesn't happen. Generally, this one step application process is only there. So they'll only judge you through this application that you are writing. So in that application, you'll have different things. You'll have your resume attached, you have your SOP, that is statement of purpose attached and all. So if your CGPA, like, you have to focus on your bright point, like your main strong point in your resume, in your SOP. So if your CGPA is not that good, not good in the sense that if you are not above 8.5 or not above 8, then you need to write in your SOP like why your grade is not that good. Because, like, specifically sometimes I have seen many people are not interested in your core field, like in engineering also. Many of you, you are like management, you have your interest in management, or you have your interest somewhere else, then you can, like, you know, just say that in your own words, in your SOP. That will do the job. And if your strong point is your CGPA, then you can mention that, okay? And also, like, basically SOP structure, if you consider it, it should be in three paragraphs. First paragraph is your introduction. That is, you say about yourself, who you are, what's your background. In very simple words, try to keep it as simple as possible. Of course, vocabulary matters, but don't take it as any, you know, English like verbal examination or something. Then don't use much, like, don't just focus much into your vocabulary. Try to keep it simple. And don't miss these points which I am telling. Try to maintain them. So in your first paragraph, you should focus on your introduction. Say about yourself. Try to tell about that. And second point should be why you are interested into this SEM exchange. So SEM exchange is basically more of a tie-up between the two universities, and it will be a cultural exchange. So why you are interested to go and learn in their university, why you are interested to go to a foreign country, what do you expect from them? That should also be there in your SOP. Like, what do you expect from this semester exchange? Like, you want your exposure, you want connections, that should also be written. And in the third paragraph, you should mention why you are a better candidate whom they should choose rather than the others who are applying. So in that, you have to write about more of your future interest, your strong points, like where you have worked. If you have more of extracurricular activities in your resume, then tell about that. If you have more of projects and, like, you know, your study, academics based activities are more, then write about that. So yeah, first para will be your introduction, telling about yourself. Second para is like what you expect and why you are interested in this semester exchange. And third para will be your strong points and why you should be chosen and not others. like in this sense. Okay, so this is what CGPA, sorry, SOP is about. And also CGPA, like if you want to mention in your about your CGPA in your SOP, then you can, but I would say that because you will be also attaching your resume, so it's not always required to mention your CGPA in your SOP. You should always, you can write that you your position in your class, like if you are in the top 10 or in the top 5, you can write that way. So that should do the case. And for the people who doesn't have that much high a CGPA, don't get pessimistic right now, because let me tell you my experience when I applied from biotech. Every year generally, this year because of COVID situation, it didn't happen actually, but then like for the last, I think 5 to 6 years, every year there's a student exchange. Student exchange happens every year. One of the other student, they go. And for my, during my time, around 7 to 8 people we applied, and there were 2 people who had a greater CGPA than mine. But then I was selected. So you see, the CGPA is not the sole criteria. Okay, your SOP matters, and how you're writing your application, that also matters. And also sometimes in the application, okay, now coming to the second part, in your application, sometimes you have to do the course mapping. So what is course mapping? Generally, what happens for CHAPAK, I saw that you will be getting your acceptance, like you will get to know the result by November itself. But that sometimes doesn't happen. Like for me, I went for Merging Voices, and in that I got my, like I applied in October, but I got the acceptance in January. So my registration was already done in December. So my 3-2, that is 6th semester registration, was already done in NIT Warangal. So I had to do my course mapping such that the courses that I had registered here in NIT Warangal for my 6th semester, and the courses which I was choosing there in that university, like in Uttar, had to have some 80 to 85% relevance. And like the total credit for 6th semester, that should be covered. That's a mandatory. Okay. Now, if you want to go for extra credits, if you want to have some more courses in that university, in your foreign university, host university, then you can go for that. If you think that you can handle more credits, you can cope up with more credits, then you can of course take extra courses apart from the courses which are mandatory, that is in the course mapping. So that's what course mapping is. And also, okay, and what else? That's what, and mainly in the application process, this only you need to write. And if you have language, like in CHAPAK, they have asked, if you have that language, like you know that language, then it's perfectly very good. You will have an extra point. But that doesn't always always is counted as a eligibility criteria in that manner, because I didn't know Portuguese, but I went to Portugal, right? So if you know English, you are studying in English only, right, in your college. So language shouldn't be a barrier. And also before applying, make your mind, because you'll have to go there, you'll have to stay there all alone, okay? It's not that I am scaring you, but sometimes it happens that it will be a cultural difference. So you should be very broad-minded. You should be able to, you know, accept, and you should be flexible enough to adjust with their cultural, with this cultural shift. Okay. So before you are applying, keep this in your mind very clear that you will have to stay there. You'll have to study there. It will be, you can say it will just be a glance of MS. If you want to go and do MS, then this semester exchange will just give you a glance. Okay. And yeah, so after you get accepted, there are certain things which need to be done. For Sherpak, actually, I'm not speaking because I don't know, like, because this acceptance, they said that the results will be out by November only. So maybe some things can be different. Maybe you have to give the NOC while you are applying. But generally, you need also a NOC, that is a no objection certificate from our college. And because this is a semester exchange, so this NOC will come in a different flow manner. Okay, so first you need to approach your department's FACAD, who handles this international relations. Okay, like research interns or like all the international relations, whatever is there. Every department has this faculty advisor. You need to know who that is for your department. You need to go to the sir. You need to show your acceptance letter, and then they'll tell you how to get your NOC. So the first process is in the process of getting an NOC for semester exchange is initiated by this faculty advisor in your department who handles the international relations. And then, of course, you need to write a letter and all, and then you need to go to this faculty. And then this letter will be forwarded to HOD, and there will be it's not called CINET, there's a term specifically, it's called, what's that term called? Sorry, I can't remember the term, but like CINET meetings happen, like that way there will be a meeting between 7 to 8 professors in your department who are senior professors, and this NOC format will be signed by all these professors. All of them will agree to give you a no objection certificate, and then you will approach Dean Academics or Dean IRA, it depends, and then they will sign, and then after that you will get a like solid NOC which you need to attach. Okay, and while you are going for visa application also, like after you are accepted for the visa application also, you need this NOC. This NOC, no objection certificate, is very, very important if you are getting accepted, because unless and until you get this NOC, you will not get your visa, and also you will not be like your attendance or your whatever, like you will still be a student of NIT Warringal, to say in lame words, like until and unless you get this NOC, you'll still be counted as NIT Warringal student. You will not be counted as a semester exchange student anymore. Okay, so yeah, after getting accepted, the main thing is NOC. You need to have a NOC, and after that only you go for the visa application process. And I'm not talking about visa application process because that's very general. It's just like what you need to do while you are going for MS. It's just the same. But yes, it's also true that sometimes you no need to come to the fees, because you will be EU-funded, like you will be getting this EU scholarship, so you no need to fee the visa application fees also. Okay, and yes, after you come back to your college, or like after your semester exchange is over, after you come back to NIT Warringal, what you need to do is, again, you need to go to this faculty advisor of your department and give him the result that you got from your foreign university. He will tell you how to, change the grades, or the grade conversion happens. So grade conversion happens, there's a particular format, because our grade conversion, it's on a scale of 10. And in EU, sometimes it's in a scale of 4. So that way the grading conversion can be done. It's easy, it's not that tough. But yeah, there's this a conversion factor is there, which will be mentioned in your result, which you get from your host university. And that way you can convert your result, that host university result, into your NIT Warringal's grade sheet. And remember, whenever you need this NIT Warringal's grade sheet, because wherever, like for your further, anywhere you are applying or whatever you are doing, then you need to have this NIT Warringal grade sheet. Then this foreign host university's result wouldn't count. Okay, because your CGPA, like total CGPA count will be done based on your NIT Warangal grade sheet only, because this grade conversion, it should be done, or else your total CGPA can't be counted. So yeah, that's a very brief thing about your application. And many people actually asked about specifically telling what is the advantage of semester exchange. I won't say advantage in that sense, but what I'll say is why you should go for semester exchange if you are eligible or if you are getting accepted is just think about the exposure you will get. Your horizon will of course broaden, like it will, you will get such a good experience. Like, let me be very true, very honest. In the beginning, maybe you feel some difficulties because there will be a cultural change. Maybe the food habits will also change. Because sometimes I've seen the vegetarian people, maybe they can face a problem because your diet, that thing can change. But those are really very small issues which can be easily handled, I think, because already in NIT you are staying in hostels, right? So that can be done. And also remember, whenever you go for the semester exchange programs, the host institute where you are going, they will be very friendly and they will always help you out in any petty issues also. Whenever they are very approachable, they're very friendly. Whenever you have any issue also for accommodation or for, any issue, you can just go to them, you can just question them and they will always help you out. And about funding. So someone like also had this question that how we will pay the fee. So you no need to pay anything. You don't have to pay a single penny. But yes, you can call this as investment maybe, because like before you reach there, the initial expenses you need to cover by yourself. Yeah, like, you know, you need to carry at least some foreign currency that has to be taken care of. And then once you are there, this all will be covered once you are there. Once you are there in that in your host university, then you will have your bank account there or whatever. You will receive your scholarship actually. You will receive your travel fare also. You will receive the health insurance and everything will be taken care by this program. Like you see, Shafaq, it will take care of your expenses. Like the same way, they'll give you a scholarship. They will take care of your health insurances, like overseas health insurances, and they will also take care of your travel expenses and everything. You don't have to pay any fees to this foreign college or anything. And in turn, you will also get a scholarship, which you are free to, you know, just, you are free to spend it anywhere you want. But yes, that's what, no need to worry about financial aid, because once you are applying through this program is specifically there for that only, for financial aids. So that you don't need to worry about. You can always apply. And also, as they said, for final years, sometimes final years are not eligible because of the BTEC by final year project only. But if our college, they allow you, if the MOU has those clause, then of course you can go. But second years and third years, I would tell you people, please try to get, because it will be a very good experience. You will get a lot of exposure, your connections, you'll make a lot of connections that will definitely help you out in your future. And that's it. And also depending upon the a program through which you are applying the tenure and for which semester you are going, for which university you are going. That will all depend upon the program you are applying through. Okay. And anything else I missed out? Okay, so specifically, if there is any weightage on publications or internships, as someone asked, as I said, your SOP will contain, it should contain all of this. You should figure it out yourself about your personal background, that which part is stronger, your extracurriculars or your academics. If your extracurriculars are stronger, like of course internships, many of you do internships in different field rather than engineering. Many of you do in management also, right? And many of you go for like competitions and hackathons and all of this. Like you can also always write those, because I have seen in foreign these extracurriculars, they have a very good like weightage. So whatever is your strong point, your good points, just mention those in your SOP. They'll definitely help you out. And just focus on your SOP mostly, because that's the only thing how they will get to know you, and that's how they will select you. So just from your resume, try to figure out what are your strong points, and that way you can okay, I'll come to your question, Himanshu. Just a few minutes. Publications also, if you have publications, definitely mention about them. Your resume already has those, and also in the SOP, maybe in one or two lines, not more than that, just write about what your work was on. What are your future prospects for that work and all those. Of course, you should mention about your publications if you have any. Okay. And GPA cutoffs and all, I already said about those. Course mapping, credit transfers, I think I said those. And so saying about the cons or the drawbacks of semester exchange, what I felt is don't just, you know, if you think that you will keep yourself in a bubble, like if you are not comfortable with this cultural shift, then you can think about it once more, because there will be a cultural shift. Of course, the language, there may be language issues sometimes, not in university, but in your day-to-day life. Because there, like in many universities, it happens, like it happened with me. We have a mess facility in NITW, but that don't happen in your foreign universities sometimes. They will have canteens. Of course, they will have canteens. You can have your lunch and dinner and all those breakfast and things in your canteen. But maybe sometimes if you think, you can also cook yourself. Like if you are having problem with the food they are providing in canteen and all, then you can cook, and that all has to be done by yourself. So more of, you know, you need to handle your academics and your personal things on your own, totally on your own. And in your day-to-day life, while you are outside, while you are not in university, if you are visiting any place, if you're going for shopping and all, and in your other things like day-to-day life, there may be some language barriers, which is not that much of a con if you are, you know, you can easily adjust. And if you learn at least some common languages, then that should really help. That shouldn't be a problem. But yeah, if you are getting selected, if you are going, don't be very restricted. Try to be with friends, try to mingle with people, and it definitely is a very good experience once you make, because you will be making many new friends. You will be having a lifetime experience, I'd say. So cons, will be that only like the cultural shift and the language hindrances, and that's it. Not many of the cons are there, but yes, if you are in a third year and if you are applying for semester exchange, then you should also you know, your focus should be not only your coursework or the credits. Like, you should only, it's not that you should only fulfill your credits. There are also labs in these foreign universities, right? So you will be anyhow talking with the professors and all. So maybe while you are working in the lab, you can talk with them and you can also work with them in any project. And your lab experiences, I tell you, it will be very different. You will have a very good and very, like, it will be totally different from the lab experiences you have in NIT Waringal. That I can say. Because, and mainly that's what, like, if you are planning for higher studies, if you are interested in engineering only, then you should definitely take this chance, take this opportunity, because you'll have a very good practical knowledge and you will get to know your standpoint in a global perspective. Because right now you are seeing only the Indian students around you, right? But there's a bigger world outside. So if you go there, you'll get to know what are the current trends, what are the current trends in technology, in everything you are, like, you will be facing the world, to be very honest. Okay. And so, as I say, there are not many cons. Okay. Is there any official website with rules and regulations? Rules and regulations as in, Himanshu, I didn't get you. Can you be more specific?
Himanshu, you can turn on your mic and you can speak.
Yeah, you can speak. Some issue. Anyhow, okay. So official website, as in, when you are applying for any program, you'll get to know the rules and regulations there only, right? There will be eligibility criteria and all. Okay, Himanshu, are you speaking? Okay. Okay, yeah, that's what, like, rules and regulations, as in, as I said, you, what should be the points to be considered while you are writing your SOP. So that's why no such rules and regulations. Official website will be the website of that program where you are applying, right? When you are applying, they will have their official website, and in that website, each and every point will be mentioned in very details. And also remember, you can always mail them if you have any queries about, you know, about this course. Like, if sometimes you may face difficulty in finding the courses, because right here, like, in our, for our university, we can, in WSTC is the intranet thing, like, for, right, from where we can do our course registrations and all. Like that, every university will have their intranet, so you can find the courses and all those things in their websites itself. But if you are facing problem, then you can always mail them, and they are very active. They will always reply you back. Keep that in mind. If you are facing any problem in finding any courses, like if you are interested in any particular course that you want to take and you are unable to find it anywhere, and if you also want to know about the course, like sometimes the course, like the course outlook and all those things, course briefings are always given in the websites. But if you don't find it enough before applying, then you can ask them that, oh, what this course is, what will it contain and all. You can always mail them and they will always answer. So official website will be that only. And translator. Okay. So translator won't be required that much, I'll say, because, you know, there's always, because when you will go to this university, maybe, you know, outside, like just think about NIT Warangal. When you are inside campus, everyone more or less knows at least Hindi or English, right?
English everyone at least knows, and you are very like we can always talk in English. So same happens in foreign also. When you are inside campus, when you are inside the university, your friends will always be there, and they are also studying there, so they are very frequent, like they'll be good in English, so you won't have any problem in conversing with them or talking to them. But yeah, of course, when you are outside, they will always help you out if you are friends and all. So they can help you out in that way. I'll just stop for a couple of minutes. I need to bring my charger. Very sorry. Some moment.
So in the meantime, we have one of our alumni. We are very fortunate to have him. Is Krishna Gupta, 2017 passed out biotechnology. He's currently pursuing his PhD at TU Dresden along with Leibniz University, like Leibniz Association. And he's in the call, and maybe like you can also get some tips and tricks from him about this CEMEX programs in general, or some extra things, extra stuff that he can tell you, which will be very valuable to us. So thanks for having. Krishna. Hello.
Yeah, I just joined. Some of my juniors, they sent a mail that there's some session going on. Do you want to join? I'll just add one point. Like Anandita handled it really well. I'll just add one very quick point. See, when we are doing a bachelor's, I was also part of bachelor. Actually, one of the first people who went for Erasmus in third year itself, which is very hard to get into. Like until then, it was believed that you only go in the fourth years. When we're doing a bachelor's, we are raised with a lot of stereotypes and prejudices. We are very shallow in ourselves. We are raised by very protective parents in households. We also live in houses like in NIT Warangal hostels, which does not actually offer a lot of, like, you are not risking anything much. So there was a lot of question that why should we go for this Erasmus? All of this shallowness, all of these things that, okay, we already have everything in our hand. All the food is already available. All the staying is... Hi, Anandita.
Oh, Krishna, you're already here. Hi.
So, we have everything in our hand. We have hostels which are taking care for us. We have pocket money which our parents get. We have so many privileges when we are raised and educated in India. When you step outside, the first time when you have to unlearn all of them, and you realize that, oh, when I was thinking about this thing, it's not actually, like, it's just one protective element which we have been taught by our parents, or something, so many different stereotypes and so many different prejudices. That is when you really unlearn and you relearn about what actually is true. When we are raised in households, we are actually transferred all the theories and the ideologies of them. You don't have your own thoughts at all. Like, there are very little thoughts which you have by yourself. It's very nice to explore a little bit of yourself. So when people ask that, how will I get a benefit in terms of placement? Probably it will not offer you benefits in placements, but it will offer you more clarity. When you have to decide between your classes, and you have to decide amongst your lab and your project, and then you have to also go back to your house, and you have to cook food, and you have to handle the house all by yourself. All of these small little challenges, they make you more refined in life. Then you will have more depth of thought, more maturity. So probably... not try it for ki arre, I'll get some nice grade, I'll probably get some nice job, I'll get some nice things to try out, I'll party. Not that. Probably try to explore yourself a little bit. When people ask that, what are the rules and regulations, and what are the things which I expected? We have a tendency of quantifying things, that we are like, arre, this is the formula of getting everything in life. World is very abstract in itself. You will probably get to know when you step out of this very formula-based thing, that you put this formula, you put this value over here, and you get this. If I do this, and I'll get achieve this. This is not how the world is. I think that is how we have been raised, that we are like, arre, tu NIT Warangal jai, you'll earn like shitloads of money. Facebook, Google will come to your house. That is a formula we have been put in. So the more exposure you have, it's not essential for you to apply for these things, but apply for internships, apply for Erasmus, apply for student exchanges, try for challenging stuff, and then you probably get more information about like what is interesting, what the world around it is, what, oh, this is what I learned throughout my life, oh, it's not actually true for the bigger picture. So all of those things. That's really interesting. Just give it a try. If you don't, so there would be a very strict rule on who can apply because the course will match and for some of them it won't match. Don't be disheartened. It's important to try. It's important to realize what is that one motivation which was the biggest selling point. It wasn't probably all of your experiences. It wasn't probably, it's very superficial when you say that, oh, I did this internship, I did this internship, I did this experience, I did this experience. You did this experience because of something. What is that underlying foundational motivation? Were you doing it for the money? Were you doing it for big amount of experience? Were you doing it for the fun of it? Find that motivation. So whenever you are under those conditions that I have to write my motivation, it's also interesting because you find ki, arre, what was interesting for me? Why am I even doing all of this stuff? Why am I even looking for internships? Why even attending all of these calls? So that small little motivation is something. The more you apply, the more you realize, the more mature you get. And I think that is more important. That's very fascinating in itself. That's a very fascinating thought. And then, yeah, just in case you have any questions, ask these guys, ask me. I think a lot of
people ask Krishna because he's literally like he is one of the like exchange students from 2018 batch, right, Krishna?
No, I was in 2015-16.
Okay, 2015-16. Okay, and yeah, he specifically, like you were asking, where from we get to know our semester exchange, like where from did we know about these things? So this guy helped us out, so you can ask him. And also, I'm there to answer.
Is Himanshu Singh, what question above? Yes. So, should I be answering the question for me?
Maybe you can because you are already in there, right?
The question is that for third year students, so now you are in third year, let's assume you're now in third year. Given the current situation wherein most foreign universities are also online, is there any relevance for semester exchange? It's kind of interesting. There's not a lot of exposure which people are getting at the moment. So you're not able to meet a lot of friends, that is true. So you will not have like Spanish friends around you and Portuguese friends and French friends around you. And you will not be having, the one reason of having these exchanges, it's not called an educational exchange, it's more like a cultural exchange. So yes, that is missing, that you will not have the best cultural exchange which would be possible, but there's always a lot of opportunities for people, for you people to meet and mingle over lunch or over dinner or a quick, so there's already a small fraternity. As soon as you join, you will be introduced to these are some set of people who came with you, and you can chat with them, you'll be like family. So, and also because your life would be kind of challenging, you would have to find some people to support you emotionally and in terms of like helping, in terms of giving you information. So you will make some friends that way. You make really good friends when everyone hates the same thing and everyone is in trouble. So those are the good friends. Actually, bachelor friends are also really good friends, but otherwise also. And then the other thing would be the classes would be, yes, held online, but that is not going to stay forever. Things might keep on changing. They might get better, then they get worse, and they get better, then they get worse. And that sweet spot where it is going fine is where you will have some of your classes and some meeting places, some parties, some discussion points, some labs will be arranged during that side. And I cannot comment entirely on how COVID is going to be in a little bit like next time. But you will not land up in trouble. Like it will not be like if you come to, let's say, if you're able to come to Europe for in France, yes, the situation is not really good, but you will not be in any trouble. It will not be like, there will be a very group, very amazing set of people who would be there to support you from the university, from the fraternity of Erasmus people. Erasmus is an international fraternity now. So in case there's any problem, they would be there to help you out. That is when you will make really good friends. And yeah, most of the class would be held online. I think most of the class will be held online, but you will still have, I think the learning part would still be quite similar to the kind of learning you have in the classroom, standard classroom environment. The real learning is outside the classrooms. So that would be still be there.
Let me, sorry to interrupt Krishna, but let me tell you a very small example, which I think I keep on repeating. So while I was writing the exams there, I saw like, you know, they here's what we do lab, like we go to lab, we do the experiment, we write the report and done. Okay, done with the experiment. Maybe we sometimes forget also, but that doesn't happen always there. So there are questions in your theoretical exams also, which are directly from your lab. Like what result did you get? Why do you think that you got this result? So here we have a tendency of, you know, we know a set of results that the results should come in this range. The output should be in this range, and we somehow manipulate and try to get that result. Maybe you guys don't do, but we used to have the tendency, right, to get that, like bring out that result, somehow manipulate the results and get that so that our grades are good. But that you can't do there. So specifically, they will like if you're getting some error or something, then you need to say why you are getting that error. Like, what do you think? What is the thing that's missing? Why you are getting that error? Why the result isn't coming? And if you can answer them, like if you have a good approach, then they will definitely think that, yeah, you have actually learned about the experiment, what's happening and all those things. And that's how the learning experience will be there. So you will definitely learn in a different way than you are learning here in Edinburgh. Okay, some differences will always be there. So yeah, that's what I want
to say. Just to continue. Yes, there's a little bit of a difference. And that is something which I also learned. I proudly call myself an engineer, but I'm doing my PhD in classical sciences now, fundamental engineering sciences. My supervisor had told me once that, Krishna, you are an engineer, you look for results, but research looks for insights. That is the kind of thought process which you have over here. You can have all different kind of results which you get, but really good minds would only go for insights. They would not go for results. Only like people who know that events, once everything has been optimized, is when you go for results. But then when you're actually thinking, oh, why is this working? Why this molecule is not working? Things like those. The smallest of the details, why they work and why they don't work, when you have to understand science, is all about insights. So that is a kind of thought process over here. It's really fascinating. It's really nice. It is quite different. So yeah, just go for that. All of these things. Try a lot of things in your bachelor's. Pick up any opportunity which you can get, and then as a student, it would be nice.
Actually, there is a question by Kavya. How did the results of your exchange semester affect your overall GPA?
So like GPA in the sense like you write exams over here, the same way you will write exams over there, and the way you write, you will score, right? The way you perform, you will score. The only difference will be that it will get, the grades you get there will be converted according to the conversion factor over here, right? So let me give you an example. If you're because there, like what happened with me, according to UTAD and according to NIT. So if I get a there, like a A grade there, it's similar to EH grade here. Okay. So it's specific, it's not that much of a difference. So it will be like, you know, like if you get so A over there is 10 points, and EX over here, 10 points. It's the same. Okay. EX grade is? What?
The letter, it's now S.
S grade now.
Oh, okay. So that's what, like the 10 point, like the highest point. So that's how it will be converted. And it's the same, like how you will perform, that way your result will be affected. It's not like, how can I say, like how you will perform, that's how your results will be. That's the thing. Am I right, Krishna?
Yeah, so I think when you're going to Portugal, I think Portugal still has English as a very, what is the language of communication over there in colleges? Is it Portuguese or is it English?
Okay, the official language, like the college I went to, it was Portuguese, but then like we Erasmus students, we had separate classes. Like then,
how many students used to be in one class usually?
We were at least around, like I was in the normal class only, but then some professors maybe, yeah, but then if you had any queries and all, they were 20 to 25 from Spain and South Africa and all those, and all of us, we
bachelor students and master students and PhD students all sitting together. And then
yeah. So it was basically like, if you had any queries, and they what I'll tell you, professors over there are really friendly. You can approach them anytime with any single doubt. They will always be happy to answer your doubts. And I thought that first I'm troubling them, because I used to have so many doubts. I always used to go to them, and they were always there with a smiling face, always ready to answer my doubts. So that's how we'll experience. Sometimes, like the university I went to, Uttar, their language was Portuguese. So sometimes maybe some courses, they told me in the beginning itself that classes will be in Portuguese. So if you want, you can attend. If you don't want, you are okay, we'll give you the materials in English, and then you can come separately. So that also happens, yes. But
so there's not a lot which is expected from bachelors anywhere in the world. I don't know, it's very complicated in India, but like anywhere else, when you're applying for masters, there's no need of publications. I got PhD usually in good institutions. I never had a publication until then. So there's not a lot of things which are expected from you. You're allowed to be curious and nice and excited when you are starting a course. That's what is usually preferred over there. You can just go and meet professors, talk to them, ask them all silly questions about anything, and they would be ready to help. Then the next question was, yes, so how easy would it be to get grades if you study? It's not really difficult to get good grades. It's not really like they will not teach you like shitloads of theory, and they're like, oh, you should know this also, you should know this also. When you're studying physics, if you have not studied Schrodinger's wave equation, what have you done in physics? They're not going to teach you all of that stuff. They'll teach you what is important, what is interesting to enter into all the different fields, just the basics. And then you can be really curious, and you can ask a lot of questions, and you can get into more details in your master's and in your PhD. If you study, you will get good grades. For me, it turned out to be fine. I was really curious. I was like, I want to study everything right now, because I hardly get the opportunity to study so many courses. So I took 126 credits in 2 semesters, which is almost equivalent to doing a master's in 10 months, more than doing a master's in 10 months. I was really crazy guy then. And they're like, I'll study, like, I have to learn how to touch snakes. So there was one course in which we were doing herpetology, in which we were talking about snakes. And in that one, I just talked to that guy, like, am I going to touch snakes? Like, yes, if you join this course, you touch snakes. Is it okay if I don't attend the class? Yes, it's okay. So I just went for the lab in which I was holding snakes. I have really nice photographs I can share. So there's really nice photographs of me holding huge Cambodian boas and things like those. And then I was doing courses in economics and languages and things like those. So you can just join anything which you like. Like, once you have cleared your criteria of mapping, then you can do any courses, and then you can be like, I like this interesting, I can join this. Then I like this very interesting, this is very interesting, we can join this. And then you can go all crazy.
It's more of an exploration, guys. If you want to explore more, you are always free to explore any dimensions you want. You can go to any dimension you want. You can, like, you are an engineering student, but you can take liberal arts course also. It's like that. Just the first thing will be, you have to do the mandatory courses, that is your course mapping. And after that, you're free to explore any amount of dimensions you want. That's what.
And then, yeah, you will probably get good grades. It's fine. Like, if you study well, you will get good grades.
So curriculum shift, Vivek, as I said, it will be more like what I saw there. They mostly focus on the upcoming technologies, okay? They, in the labs or in the classes also, they will be mostly focusing on the papers, lab papers and all, what are the research going on. And yeah, it will be more of like, you will not only be learning the theory, you'll be learning the theory at the same time, the practicals also. So it will be a bit different from what you see here. But not that different here. Maybe we do the things on ourselves. We are not those are not mandatory over here. But there also, they don't force you, like, you have to do this, or like you have to go, you have to study this research article. Let's just tell you. And then if you have interest, you can of course go and you can of course read more. You can read about that research article, you can read about that experiments and all. So yeah, there is a little difference in the mostly I will say there are differences in the practical courses like the labs and all, but theory and all there will be not much different. Okay, yeah, that's what. Any more questions from the house?
And then I think there's also, see, let the magic stay. If you tell you everything, then you will not, it will be like Paris syndrome. When you are like, hi, everything we know already, everything is so nice and beautiful. When you go over there, it's not, it does not live up to the magic. The magic is in not telling all the details. Probably get selected, try to find these opportunities. They're really exciting.
First, just take this opportunity, guys. Just apply. You will get to know so many things. Just apply. Don't think that whether I get selected or not. What? Just you are getting the opportunity. Just apply.
And if you cannot apply because the course does not match really well, don't get disheartened. Like, you will have multiple opportunities. Just look for exploring a lot. You can be exploring different fields of art or skills in your house, but the idea is just to explore different things. So that is when you learn a lot. You learn a lot about yourself. You learn like exciting new stuff to tell. So it's nice.
Ratio of applications, I would like to say, like, as you will see while you are applying for the program, in the list of colleges, like there will be a list of eligible colleges. In that you can see what all colleges are allowed, like what all colleges actually have the MOUs. So what all colleges are allowed to apply for the program. In that way you can know, like, of course, ratio, as in I also didn't get what ratio are you asking for. Like the ratio of Indian students
to acceptance rate or something.
Okay.
I don't know, like in different universities in India, it is quite different. So Indians are quite competitive. They do want to look for more opportunities. They do want to try a lot of different things. They also organize such Google Meets, Zoom calls like these one where all the juniors come together. So, and then the college also supports the same way they are supporting in NIT Warangal. So there are a lot of applications usually. But there's a difference between a good application. Like I have seen review applications, how applications are reviewed over here for PhD, for master's, for bachelor's. Try to be real. Just like put your true motivation, the deepest thoughts. Why do you actually want to do that? And you will have a really high chance getting into it. Don't be like, Ari, I've done this also. I want to go to next mission of NASA. I want to touch Pluto and I want to come back in one single hour. Let's not put such really ambitious thoughts. Try to be real. Why I want to do that? Why do I want to even apply for this Chirpak scholarships? Why do you want to come to France? Why do you want to? So all of these why questions, right? Try to figure out yourself. Why do you want to do that? And whatever answer comes, just write it down. And then if you're able to do that, there would be really high chances of you getting in. And that is good enough. I think that is a tendency, writing that I have done this is something which I've seen a lot of people applying from Indian universities, also from a lot of other universities, but a very specific geographical domain. That is something which is not seen really well over here in review applications, when people just write, I've done this. Don't get into that kind of things. Just be real, like write why you're interested. Why do you want to do all of those things? You can always say that I don't know what I want to do in life, but I still want to apply because I want to explore. Or you can be like, someone introduced me to this one and then I just want to give it a shot. And that can also be your motivation, right? It is what it is. You cannot say that this is good and this is bad. So you can just write what it is truly. And then in case you're able to be true, it's good. Then I'll probably answer this question. Anirudh has said that, okay, how much expense we have to bear initially and how many days it takes for the visa approval and other formalities. If you want to take clothes and if you want to take masalas from India, that's the expense you have to bear. suitcases, probably a new suitcase, and probably some gifts for people from different countries, just as like small gifts from my side that makes very good friendships. I think that is the expense. And then there will be a little bit of other small expenses too, like flight tickets, but you'll get it back, and other expenses, but it will be handled. It's fine. You just pick up the opportunity first, and then in case they will help you with all of those things. I remember. I'll tell a small
SOP difference, Krishna. There's also a question about SOP difference between semi exchange and research intern.
Very, very big fundamental differences. So statement of purpose is you writing a small or a big statement about. So actually, it's a very detailed question. Okay, let me first finish the last question about the visa approval and formalities. I'll tell you a small story. So I was in Hyderabad doing an internship when I got my acceptance letter by mail. And then in Europe, they put, instead of a comma, they put a dot. And instead of a dot, they put a comma. So 1,000 euros was written as 1.000. That was my stipend during that time, allowance. And then I see my mail and I'm like, because when I applied, I did not make sure what was actually happening. So when I saw the mail, I'm like, they're going to give me 1 euro. And I'm like, how much will a view? So I'm checking on the internet, how much does a euro cost? Like, how much can I survive in a euro in Poland? And then I called my sister. I told my sister next day. And they're like, they're going to give me 1 euro because for Ananda, it might be because it was 800 euros. So there's no comma.
Yeah, 800. No, there was no comma.
1.000. But like in the end, everything got sorted out. And I realized that they put a comma instead of a dot. And then I did not have to deal with a lot of expenses. Rather, I made more money out of Erasmus than I actually ever paid it to NIT Warangal. Yes. Okay. Now I wanted to tell the story. I don't know why, but yes. Next point is there any major difference between SOP for this semester exchange and SOP for internship? I think Anandita wouldn't be able to answer this question. I have not.
You answer. I also want to listen.
So, there's one fundamental difference is that you are not targeting a very specific group or a research lab, but you are rather applying for very generic idea. When you're applying for research internships in specific labs, they have sold themselves and you are trying to sell yourself, but you're also telling, oh, you tried to sell yourself. We realized that, oh, you do this, all of this nice stuff. And we came across this and then we really like how you visualize the world and so on. In SOPs for semester exchange, you are trying to sell your motivation alone. It's a one-sided conversation. You're just trying to sell your, and you're going to leverage on, okay, if I want to have some exposure or things like those, there's not a lot of difference. And there's no structure between like, there's a structural difference between SOP for research internships and SOP for semester exchange. There are certain questions which have to be answered in both of them. Why do you want to?
But maybe Krishna, maybe in research, what I think, maybe I'm wrong, correct me if I'm wrong, that in research intern, you want to, you're looking for a project, right? And that lab or that specific university you are applying, they're focused on a specific domain of research. So you need to explain them like you are interested into that kind of research. Yeah. But in semester, it's not like that, right? You are looking for just like that. So research intern is more narrowed down and semester exchange will be a broader aspect. That's it.
And then the next things would be, how do you structure them really well? So a really good structure is really important for writing any kind of SOP. So as a general rule of thumb, which I always tell people, when you write a paragraph, the paragraph should only be paraphrased in one single line. So for example, when you are saying that, okay, I have done my bachelor's in NIT Warangal, I'm doing my bachelor's in NIT Warangal, and then I have done this. In one paragraph, you should only talk about your bachelor's, all your academics and your experience in bachelor's. And then you should put a paraphrase that my experience in bachelor's has been really nice and things like those, or I'm doing really well in my bachelor's. My bachelor's experience is full of cultural and curricular activities. your paragraph should only speak one thing, and that should be paraphrased in one single line, should be put either on top or the bottom of the paragraph. So once someone reads your paragraph, and I think that it's a part of technical writing, it's a part of very good writing, that you write, a good structure would only mean that you answer three questions. Every paragraph should have one answer, and it should be paraphrased at the top or at the bottom of each paragraph. So when you're picking up writing SOP for semester exchange, you can write three paragraphs, but because you don't have to talk about labs, you can be like, oh, I'm doing my bachelor's, but the next paragraph instead of could be like about cultural exchange and how much do you want to try out different things and about different things which you already know about world, and then how is it going to help you. On the other hand, when you're applying for research internships, it's going to be a little bit about yourself. So first paragraph is going to be the same one. Second paragraph is about to be why do you want to come to this lab and this specific project. And then you put all the paraphrasing around here and there. And then third one, you again about to talk to about your future and how this lab is going to help you. Previously, it was about how this experience is going to help you. But in research internship, it's going to be how this lab is going to help you in terms of career and things like those. That is one rule of thumb which I can tell you, and then you can explore, make a lot of mistakes, discuss with a lot of your friends. If you have more questions, ask us. It should not be we telling you that this is a formula, because we are used to so much of formulas already. It's already so difficult. Try to make a mistake. Ask us, well, how do we feel about it? How do we perceive the exact same way? How you want us to perceive you? And then in case we perceive the same thing, then you're doing really good. And if not, then you need to find out what went wrong, how it should be written. That's a learning process. It's really nice.
Yeah, I would like to answer Malika's question. She is asking about Erasmus. Is Erasmus open right now? Last year, it was pre-COVID, like before COVID itself, I went to Jacoma sir to ask about Erasmus and some other exchange programs. By that time, there were some other issues going on, not related to COVID, but there were some issues because of which we were not allowed to enroll for Erasmus last year. This year, the situation is different, and Erasmus deadline is after the Charpak deadline. So that's why we wanted a combination of the sessions for a specific semex thing. And if Erasmus is open, the best person who can answer this question is Jaykumar sir. And if it's open, then we'll let you know. Excuse me.
So about these programs, which are open for NIT, and is it open or not? All this you will get to know from the MOUs. Okay, so I have seen, me also, we didn't have this tendency of going to our official website. But all this information, trust me, they are there in the official website. So if you once go to the official website, you can see about the MOUs. And then you can get to know if you are if our college is eligible or not. If not, if you are not finding the information, then you can always contact the deans, right? The dean IRA, he or she can apply. He or she can answer you these questions, actually, whether the MOU stands or not, whether our college is eligible or not. So yeah.
Actually, I have one question. So if there is someone who has applied for research intern, he got it, and then he's applying for this semex program for January to May. So is it possible to go for both of them, or is it only one we have to choose?
So it will depend when the research intern is, right? If it's in summer,
research. May, July.
Yeah, so if both of them are not clashing, if both of them are in a different time period, then of course you can go. No problem in that.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? Which one to prefer if both clash? See, that will more of your personal interest, right? Your future interest or your personal interest. What if you want to, you know, you are very specific, you already know you want to work. Like, let me speak about biotech only. Biotech is such a, not only biotech, all the engineering right now I'm doing biomedical, and I can see it's so interdisciplinary. There are mechanical engineers, electronics engineers, materials engineers, CSE people doing computational stuff, and they're also studying for biomedical, right? So it's actually about your future interests. If you are right now, when you are applying, if you are clear that you want to work in this specific domain and you are getting the research intern in that particular domain, then maybe you can go for research intern. But if you are still having those doubts and confusions in your head, if you want to still explore more, if you want to know that, okay, if you still want to know like where my interest lies, what I feel more excited to do, which one is I'm more interested into, then you can go for student exchange. That's it. So it will depend totally on your personal interests. If you are looking for that particular project, like the project is really good, if you think that, yeah, this project is good, like it serves your interest, then go for that research intern. That's how I will answer. Let's, Krishna, what do you say?
Very interesting question. So we are in NIT Warangal right now. When you get one opportunity and then you pick it up, there would be multiple options in life, and also frequently nowadays when you have so many options available and they keep on clashing. But then you discuss with your friends, you discuss with the most immediately affected people, and then decide what would make the most amount of sense. So if you get both of the options, when you're like, I will also get a research internship over here, I'm also getting through Chirpak scholarship, I'm also getting through MyTech scholarship, then you discuss with as many people as much as possible. You make a small, nice, very table at what will help me in terms of financial goals, in terms of personal goals, in terms of career goals, and come to Anandita, come to people from IG, talk to Vivek, talk to me, talk to everyone you know. Just arrange calls. Everything is online now. So you could be like, "Arey, I got this thing. What should I do? I was thinking I should go for this one, but this also feels nice," and so on. And then we have a really nice discussion about also talking about you. What do you like a lot? Which goals do you want to achieve in terms of personal, financial, in terms of personal like career goals? And then we finally decide. It is nice because I think after you graduate from NIT Warangal, you will. If you are doing masters, you'll have so many master admits. Once you join a company, after a certain point of time, after you're placed and you join a company, you'll have so many offers from companies. You all will be doing so great, and you'll have so many options in your hands. For anything which you get in terms of multiple options, that's the thing which you have to do. You have to talk to as many people as much as possible. You have to discuss as much as possible, and then you decide. That's what you're going to do over here also. Does that answer the question?
Yeah, that's what I was actually going to ask. Like, yeah, he says it answers. Okay, good. And yeah, like many of, I specifically got a question about why I chose biomedical. It's not from SEM exchange, but still, I would say not only for biotech people, for other mechanical, electronics, and everyone. Right now, if you look at the world and the technological advancements and all the technological trends and all, it's highly interdisciplinary. Let me give you a very small example. In because I'm studying in biomedical, I can say this. So when we develop this stent, a little stent, which is put inside our arteries, like coronary artery or anything. So it needs prepare from so many domains, right? You need to know about the material. You need to know about the mechanical behavior of the material. And also some other things, like it's highly interdisciplinary, all the research work and all of this. So of course, I would not say that placements and all are not good. Of course, every experience counts. But
if you are not satisfied with what you learned in bachelor's, then please go for master's, because you will literally learn so many things when you are in master's. And don't just restrict yourself, guys. So just try to explore. What I have seen, many of us, we just do our coursework, we get a high grade, and then we are very satisfied and we're like, okay, we have this much of CGPA, we feel very happy. But that will only serve a very small cause. After some time, you can see you will not be satisfied. Okay, sometimes that only CGPA will not count. And also I've seen many people who doesn't have that great a CGPA, but has a very good knowledge, and they are so updated. They know about what's happening outside the world. So right now, apart from your course studies, just see around you and just look at the things going around you. Keep yourselves updated, explore yourselves, just know what all is happening. And apart from your courseworks, also please update yourselves about the technological advancements happening and all those things. You will enjoy your study process, I tell you. Okay. So that's how I figured out why I am interested into biomedical, because when I was doing biotech, I found out that this bioelectronics thing is what I like to study about, to learn about. And that's how I found out that biomedical is where my interest lies. Maybe after some time I'll get to know that, okay, I was wrong, but still I'm also exploring. And yes, writing for my GATE paper, actually, I first thought I will write for biomedical paper, not biotechnology paper. That's when I found out that it's 90% electronic, not 90%, 85% or 80% is electronics. So from then only I knew that I have to learn about electronics and I have to learn about mechanical things also. But then, yeah, I took up that challenge, and that's what I'm also learning right now, right? So that's how I figured out I like biomedical, just by going through the recent developments and like the studies going on, the research is going on. That's it. That's how I figured out. Someone, I really don't remember the name, but someone asked me this question. So I tried to answer that also. Okay.
Ananta, you're mute.
Yeah, actually, I'm reading the question. I'm sure about what I'm diving into. As I said, like I looked about the course curriculums and like not only the course curriculums, like what a biomedical engineer's role is in this society. I looked for that, like what all are the domains where I can work, or like, you know, what a biomedical engineer's role is. I looked on that, and then I knew that yes, I want to be this kind of engineer, a bioengineer and a biomedical engineer, to be that much sure. That's how that's why I dived into it. Of course, there were hurdles, there are challenges, I'm still tackling them. But yes, I am happy learning in this learning course. That's what. I don't know if that answers your questions, but yeah, that's how I chose. Okay, my GATE score and rank, it was not that good, guys. That was a huge mistake. I'm still repenting. It was in 400s. Okay, my rank was in 400s. My interview process was actually good. I did a very good thing in my interview, and so I got selected. And specifically, I went for IIT Hyderabad because I still don't know, because online classes are going on. But from their website and from their prospectus and all those things, I saw that the professors, their backgrounds, like their research works, actually the lab research works are really good. They're working into very good projects, and the lab facilities also are really good. So that's why I chose IIT Hyderabad. In fact, whenever you are choosing for any institute or for any lab, first of all, look into that lab website and then see what all projects they're working, where their research interest lies, and the facilities and the, like, you know, the faculties and the people's working. And then I think you will be able to figure out, like, whether it goes or it matches with what you are looking for, your interest. And then you can decide, right? Can you give us a rough idea of application process in terms of timeline? Application process as in semester exchange, is it, Virat? Okay. So it depends on the program, I'd say, because see, for me, what happened for Marching Voices, the application process, like the application form, it came during October end. Yeah, just like this. It came during October end, and we had the deadlines up to November. I applied, then I didn't know what was happening, and then I got my approval or my acceptance in January. So I applied in October 2018. Yes, October 2018 I applied, and I got accepted in January 2019. And the semester was from February 19 to July 19. So I was in Portugal from February 19 to July 19. Yeah. That's what the timeline was for Marching Voices. For Chapak, it's different, I think, as I saw from the process. It's like you will get your results by the end of November only, I think, if I'm not wrong. And also for Erasmus Plus, I think, which Krishna went, it was for a whole year. It was two semesters. So for that, Krishna, can you tell the timeline for that to them?
I think the timeline is very much dependent on the program. So for them, they had to tell the course mapping in advance. I did not have to do the course mapping in advance. Rather, mine was a very funny story, because I just met a friend and he was walking out of the biotech department. I used to talk to a lot of people. I was very talkative. I used to go to the department, talk to the professors. So there's one guy who was my senior, Ankit Barla, who was just walking. And I just called him, bhai, where are you going? And he was like, I am going to take one certificate of proficiency from the English department. I'm like, why? So you're like, I am applying for the student exchange. I'm like, let me take out my mobile and note that down. The deadline was in 2 days. So for me, it worked out, because I could do it in 2 days. And because I was just so used to applying for internships and things like those, everything is already ready. But on the other hand, I think it takes around, let's be very realistic, you will have a lot of stuff to handle from the coursework. You are staying at your house nowadays. Let's take around a month for things, depending on what all things are supposed to be done. There will be a lot of things which you'll have to ask and so on, I think. But it will also be very dependent on what kind of program does Charpak offer and what kind of program do other scholarships offer. I don't think so we can quantify a timeline.
Actually, we can't speak in general about the timeline, because it's very much the program oriented, like what the program is specifically about. In that way, we can frame the timeline. I think it varies from program to program. So speaking in general can't be done, I think, about the timeline. Yeah.
But then if you're interested, you have to try.
Yeah.
Here and there.
If you're interested, like, you will have to do anyhow. That's it. Like, timeline can't be generalized in this sense. It depends on from the program to program. Anything else, guys?
So I guess there are no further queries or questions. So yeah, it was very nice having you both, Ananita and Krishna, for this session. And I guess all the juniors have got a clear idea about what exactly CEMEX is and how to go about it and what experiences they can gain through the CEMEX exchange programs such as Erasmus or CHARPAC, which is going to come in a couple of weeks right now. So it was very good having you, and fortunate also. So yeah, to conclude all these things, I feel that I hope that juniors will take a good opportunity of these programs and try for it, not thinking about mera kya hoga, if I get the positive result or negative result, but irrespective of that, I feel that they will apply for it, and let's hope for the best. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, and then
Yeah, just keep exploring. And then also I'd like to say, if you have any more doubts, you have my mail IDs, right? You have my student mail ID. You can always drop a mail. I'm saying this, I'm mentioning this specifically because right now I'm also with this online courses, it's really difficult, you know, so I'm not that much active in WhatsApp or in Facebook and social media. So maybe you get a reply a little late if you ping me in the social media. So if you mail me, because I'm always stuck with this laptop in front of me, so maybe you get a reply faster if you mail me. Okay, so
not drop me messages, no issues. I'm
always, yeah, he is always online. He's
I love talking to people. I'm very curious, yeah, as a person. I love talking to people, so any questions, just drop me messages. Ghar wale mujhe bahane nikalne de rahe, drop me a message. I love gossiping and ranting about things, and I love sharing about talking about science. So yeah.
Okay, that's it, guys. Thank you. Yeah. Thanks a lot. It was really nice talking to you. And yeah, of course, feel free to reach us anytime you want. Okay. Bye.
Yeah. Thanks a lot. Bye bye.
Yeah.